I've been on a search to try and find the appropriate language to talk about the artists that I know to be important in my life, in my neighborhood, for my people, for my culture. And that gives us a legitimate place in the universe of creatives. I'm Percy Mabandu, and you're watching Disruptive Natives. I remember growing up hearing a particular tone of a trumpet, you know, and even today when I hear Huma Sikela's Boma Sikela, that track composed by Kaifa Semenya, I associate it with a particular mood and time in my upbringing at home as a kid. You know, I can still see the vinyl on a telephone can, you know, record player. And, you know, there was a particular tone in Huma Sikela's record that I associate with, the, you know, with my upbringing. The same way that I associate a particular type of cooking with the spirit of my mother in my neighborhood, you know? And so coming out of that space means that you are very alive to the idea of music and the gathering of people as a site of identity formation. But beyond this casual kind of thing, you know, when I was growing up, goes on to, we had, you know, at any given weekend, Bramaik Muhle, who's a painter, Aiken Kwana, who's a sculptor and painter, Tony Mako, who was an educator and a painter, Johnny Ruberu, who's a sculptor, kind of, you know, a printmaker, painter as well. So there's all these artists, you know, who are there. And then of course you've got the heritage guys who, you know, who were in exile. You know, I mean, Lefifi Tladi, growing up in Harango, you'll be told about, you know, you'll be stories about how they as kids did this art thing. Because I'm a history buff and, you know, art history becomes, you know, an easy space for me to go. And as a student of art history, you know, it means that I have a tool to understand my own neighborhood. I have tools to understand my own upbringing within the art history of this country we call South Africa, or the country that now, the country that will hopefully one day call itself Azania, if you will. Around the song. So I was interested in yakhal'inkomo for those various reasons, but also because it you know, it happened in 1968, which is a very interesting time in black life anywhere, right? You know, what becomes the Paris riots actually begin in the Congo with student riots, you know, and then we know what they did in Algeria to black people there. We know that Martin Luther King in the US, you know, was cut down that year. Exactly 12 months as Mankunku goes into studio, John Coltrane had passed on, you know, and we know Coltrane's importance in African jazz and to Mankunku personally as a musician.
Like dedication.
And hence dedication in you know, the second track in that album. And so, you know, that same year, Swaziland gets its independence, you know, and also Biko is elected as president of SASO. 1968 is the birth organizationally of the Black Consciousness Movement, right? It's also 4 years since Mandela and them are thrown into jail. So it's 4 years of a hiatus when apartheid was sure of its dominance. You know, there was no real organized resistance until that time when these kids, you know, these young people start coming up in 68. So it's a very pivotal moment. It represents a particular awakening. And it's an elegant awakening, it's a beautiful awakening, but also a very spiritual awakening, as much as it's a very smart and clever and street awakening, because that's jazz manages to allow us to talk about all of these things at once. We have a complete sense of what our democracy is about in our heads, but so we don't put in enough work into it. So there's a kind of paucity of journalism, you know, because, you know, we think things are already there, but they're not, right? There's a paucity of production. There's more. We're consuming more than we are producing because we think the things are there. Right, but the things that, so we are not putting in the right kind of work. I don't know if I'm making sense, but there's a kind of, you know, people are not producing as much as they should because they think the shit is there. People assume the shit is there, but it's not. What is the magic in if Rami Ngatane's paintings, the color, the riotous beauty in that in Soweto that he paints about, right? It's to invoke him with the same sophistication formally to look at his work and say, you know, this is what it means to us. This is the energy, these are the tensions that it explores about us. You know, when Mankunku's saxophone just swings low, you know, and you can hear that bellow, you know, and you are recognizing that bellow from the car that was slaughtered at your uncle's wedding. And so making that connection is to kind of legitimize the rituals, you know, the presences, the lives. It's an act of seeing, and that's an act of struggle. That's an act of humanizing ourselves. It's an act of taking ourselves back, you know, our cultures back, our peoples back, our graves back, if you will, and insisting on saying we are alive, we're here, see us. And even if you want, we see ourselves and we're cool like that. So growing up, Fikile Magadlela, the painter, the poet, has this set of drawings, I think in around 1978, called Dance of the Second Creation. If you look at those drawings, man, they represent the particular type of black, an ethereal blackness, if you will, an ethereal expression of what it means to be black, the elegance of love, you know, of being. They're beautiful, beautiful human. They're unreal in a sense that there's a kind of fantasticness, you know, about how he represents those figures in those drawings. But it's a very important time to do that because it's on the back of the death of Biko, a very beautiful human being. It's on the back of 76. He's coming into the world, you know, to, you know, where as a young person, his own humanity has been denied, right? And the act of being creative, you know, for Fikile Magadlela at the time, the act of dreaming, the validity of his dreams, the validity of his visions, the validity of his own elegant capacity as a draftsman, as a drawer, as a painter. It's exactly about, you know, testing the limits of his own humanity and affirming, you know, his own existence. And that for me is what it's about. It's about trying, without making a lot of noise, just being beautiful, and by doing that you win. There's this guy, you know, in Harangu when I was growing up, you know, he used to have this joke, is that, you know, you see such and such a brow, such and such an uncle could be down and out and dirty on the corner, and he would say, just give him a job and see what happens 2 weeks into that job, right? You see how he comes back alive. There's honor in working hard and improving yourself, right? This idea of self-improvement in black life is a political idea. It's, you know, an act of struggle. Just to pull yourself by the straps of your boots and be beautiful, right? And this is why art has been such an important thing in black life against, you know, the struggle. Or, you know, against the onslaught of colonial assault, you know, being beautiful has been the one thing they could not do anything about, because that has to do with how I treat myself. That's to do with how I carry myself, you know, how the yard that I live in, the lawn is clean, you know, the flowers in my yard, how I paint my house, however small and matchbox it is, you know, how I treat my house is an expression of my elegance, you know, and that communicates a particular vitality of my humanity, if you will, and that is, you know, it becomes a kind of bulwark against entropy, against the grand dehumanization project of our people. You know, I think artists need to bear witness, however way they do it, you know, that's it. Bear witness and be beautiful. Create work, you know, bear witness to our culture. Co-create our culture with us, for us. I think that's all artists have to do, however way. But, you know, but most fundamentally is to be good at what they do. You know, the world needs more plumbers than lousy artists. I'm terrified of the idea that I have to find ways to prepare my son for racism. All right, that there are people who are going to hate you just because you exist. It terrifies me. I have specific moments that I remember as a kid with my dad, who was struggling from stroke at the time, and walking in town, and these guys in a bucky wearing Army Surplus uniform just charging us, you know, just revving the car. I don't want my kid to go through that shit, you know. But I think, you know, if anything, the greatest legacy my parents left for me, and I think I'll be able to leave for my kids, or my son specifically, Nkhopotse, is capacity to be creative in whatever you do. Just be creative, and you know, invest in that self-esteem. You know, love of self will carry you through anything in the world. Just have self-regard, be respectful, and riches of the world flow from there. You know, when you love yourself, you'll do right by yourself and others. You know, and when you love yourself, you'll understand the importance of hard work. When you love yourself, you'll understand the importance of virtuosity. All right, and black virtuosity has always been expressed by ordinary men and women making insurmountable odds look easy. All right, and that's what it is. You know, the jewels have all been laid down. Just connect with your history, and make it fly. You know, it's just what it is. We do what we do. For Johnny Janimbizo, great bassist of the Blue Notes fame. When I swim in my music, a hamatan of colors becomes an area of feeling where a rainbow of feathers peoples all space, dancing in my heart. Here, I do not even know what flowers pop out of my eye. I move without even touching air. Johnny, you take us out there where we gasp silently amidst the bombardment of sound in the spell of a witch doctor's son, where I cannot even ponder how a witch and a doctor paradox could be one entity. Your bass, Johnny, pins nothing down. Your bass rides on wave or height or rock or depth or crevice of sound to bathe us in music. Yeah. And we are moved. Where we cannot even